Hi folks, we'll get started in just a moment. We have a lot of people still signing on. Welcome. Hi everyone, welcome. This is Diane Regas. We're going to get started with our wonderful conversation today, but we'll start with a brief welcome video. Welcome. So glad you could join us today. Welcome to the Park Bench Chat. I'm Diane Regas, the president and CEO of the Trust for Public Land. We've been hosting these conversations for a couple of years now, and they've been a really wonderful way to connect folks around the country. And today's conversation is on federal funding for achieving park equity. So today's conversation and the webinar is going to focus on the significant influx of federal funding available to cities and communities, and some of the important questions about how we rethink, plan, and invest in our cities and communities in ways that maximize the multiple benefits, equity, and justice. So for those of you who are joining us for the first time, just a very quick introduction to TPL, the Trust for Public Land. For 50 years, the Trust for Public Land has been working to connect everyone to the outdoors, the benefits, and the joys. As a national nonprofit, it is our fundamental mission to work directly with communities to create outdoor places where they are needed most. In the US today, access to quality parks and outdoor spaces is not equitable. Decades of neglect and injustice have left too many communities behind and without quality places to get outside. Today, 100 million people, including 28 million kids, do not have access to a quality park within a 10-minute walk of home. And neighborhoods where the majority of residents identify as Black, Hispanic, Asian, Indigenous, do not have, and low income, have access to half as much park space than white and higher income communities. The TPL is leading a movement to close this outdoor equity gap once and for all by protecting iconic public lands, by creating joyful parks, by transforming asphalt schoolyards into green, joyful places. And we connect communities with trails, and we are preserving outdoor spaces that reflect the history and culture of all American communities. We do this work because whether you live in a dense city or a remote rural area, access to the outdoors is essential for well-being, for public health, for climate resiliency, and for community cohesion. So working to protect and create new green spaces is an essential element of the work we need to do at this pivotal moment in time, where collectively, as a nation, we're faced with multiple challenges and the imperative to address racial and economic inequities, declining health, especially mental health, and increasingly severe impacts of climate change and the deep divisions we are facing in communities across this country. How we rise to the challenges that we face today is going to define the future generations. One of the responses has been the tremendous influx in federal funding, including through the Bipartisan Infrastructure Act, the Inflation Reduction Act, and there's significantly more funding available to invest in green infrastructure. We believe there's at least $18 billion and more available for these investments. And this funding will transform our environment. It'll transform the way we renew our communities, rebuild our transportation systems, rebuild housing, and the ways that we protect our natural environment for future generations. This means that we all have an opportunity now to help close the outdoor equity gap. And we need to do so in ways that invest in projects that maximize the benefits for health, for climate, for economics, for quality of life, and for community. In addition, we have an opportunity to ensure that funding is distributed to communities that have been historically underinvested and marginalized, for whom this funding has not always been accessible. So to advance this work, TPL is working with municipalities around the company, around the country, community partners around the nation. We're building coalitions to share the evidence of what works, share tools for how to advance these investments, and cultivating a diverse new leadership cadre for the 21st century. And we're excited to be hosting this webinar today as a step in building awareness about what the funding opportunities are. As we go through today's program, I encourage you to submit questions through the Q&A function that you should probably see at the bottom of your screen. We may not be able to get to all those questions today, but we can follow up with you afterwards. And your questions help us think through what webinars to present in the future. So before we transition to the panel discussion, we have a wonderful panel today, three incredible leaders, one from the White House, one mayor, and one local community leader. We're gonna start with a little briefing just to level set everyone on some of the background. We'll hear from Bill Lee, TPL Senior Vice President of Policy, Advocacy, and Government Relations. Bill leads our organization's strategic direction and implementation of public policy. So Bill, let me turn it over to you to share some insights.
Thank you very much, Diane, and good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here, and thanks for joining us. As Diane said, we're in a special moment here. The federal government has made unprecedented amounts of funding available so that we, working together, can increase people's access to nature, whether that's parks or trails, green schoolyards or bike paths. By virtue of several historic laws and passed by Congress and the president, and by virtue of President Biden and this administration's focus on the Justice 40 initiative and the America the Beautiful initiative, this funding is also targeted to the places that can benefit most. And that's the other thing that has really struck me about this moment. As Diane said, there is historic amounts of funding available, but the administration, Congress, the agencies, our state and city and community partners are really working to get that money to the places that have been left behind sometimes, to the under-resourced communities where that equity, that park equity gap is really huge. Trust for Public Land sees this as a once-in-a-generation moment. There is huge opportunity. We need to move quickly to make sure this money is spent well and it's spent correctly in the right places. And we're really excited to work with you, our federal agency partners, our cities, our mayors, and the nonprofit community partners to begin to close the park equity divide. Next slide, please. Four historic pieces of legislation, just as background, have led to this moment that we're in. There's been a lot of talk about the Inflation Reduction Act and the bipartisan infrastructure law, formerly known as the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act. But there were also two other pieces of legislation that help create funds that could be used for open space and parks. The first is the Great American Outdoors Act, which fully funded, the Land and Water Conservation Fund for the first time, fully and permanently funded it. And the second is the American Rescue Plan Act, which responded to the pandemic in the early months of the pandemic. Those four laws together have provided more than $18 billion in new or enhanced funding for parks, for open space, and for trails. In the next couple of slides, I want to take you through some of the programs in those acts, and those legislation that can fuel equitable parks. In the first, the Great American Outdoors Act, under that is a program called the Outdoor Recreation Legacy Partnership Program. It's a real mouthful, but the great thing about it is that ORLP is one of the few federal programs that has a competitive grant that's focused on parks in cities, parks and recreational assets in cities, especially the cities that have park deserts. This year, there's $192 million, that's a record amount, available for ORLP. And this is due in large part to you, the park advocates, and fighting with TPL over the past several years. We've moved that number from, I think 5 or 6 years ago, was at $4 million. Now it's at $192 million available this fiscal year. I'm really pleased to have Juan Perez Saez join us today. He's the executive director of ELK, a community-based nonprofit in Denver. And they, along with the city of Denver and TPL, were critical to bringing one of the first ORLP grants to Denver to build Montbello Park, which is a gorgeous park with a climbing boulder provided by North Face. It's just a beautiful addition to the wonderful parks in Denver. For groups that are thinking of cities or community groups that are thinking of applying for ORLP, thanks for staying on this for 1 second. There's a link there at the bottom for the ORLP grant application toolkit that TPL put together that will walk you through the grant process and the eligibility, how to apply, when to apply, et cetera. There is one deadline coming up really quickly this January and another at the end of May this year. Thank you. Next slide, please. The second piece of legislation that I wanted to highlight is the American Rescue Plan Act. Under that, there were two pots of money, the state and local fiscal recovery funds and the elementary and secondary school emergency relief funds, both of which have been used to create parks and green spaces in cities. For example, Lexington, Kentucky used $25 million of ARPA funds on parks and recreation and playgrounds. And East Cleveland used $6 million of their ESSER funds to create six different pilot projects for community green schoolyards in East Cleveland. Next slide, please. The Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, which is better known as the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law, is one of these once-in-a-generation investment opportunities. I'm most excited about the opportunity this law creates for cities and communities to build trails, bike trails, pedestrian trails, pathways, and green infrastructure. These are, as we build connected, equitable, walkable cities, resilient cities, these networks of trails are one of the ways that we're bringing them to life. One upcoming grant opportunity I want to point out is under that first bullet there. The DOT RAISE grants are deadline coming up. Proposals are due on February 28th of this year. RAISE funds could be used to create parks, trails, bike paths, and pedestrian walkways that improve safety or the economy or connectivity. And that last bullet there, I want to point out, EPA has a number of programs that can be used for green space and green infrastructure. And one of them is the State Water Clean Water State Revolving Fund. It's now got $11.7 billion as a result of the bipartisan infrastructure law. And that can be used for funding, as I said, green space, acquisition of open space, et cetera. And I want to focus on, I'm going to focus on one other EPA program in the next slide, please. The fourth law was the Inflation Reduction Act, which was passed most recently of these four laws, passed in 22. The first four programs listed here are all new programs, and those billions of dollars are going to be distributed through competitive grants. One of the ones that TPL is most excited about is the EPA Environmental and Climate Justice Block Grants. That funding can be used to help community groups develop their capacity to apply for and manage federal grants so they can bring dollars to their communities and not have it just go to the usual suspects. And that's a real big hope of TPL. And I know all of the panelists here today, we've got to make sure that these dollars get to the communities that maybe don't have a lobbyist here in Washington, and maybe they don't have a grant writing or a big grant writing office. But working together at the federal level, at the NGO level here, like TPL, acting as a navigator, and with the cities and communities, we believe we can make historic investments this year. As we get more information on each of these programs, we'll be sharing it out widely through the 10-minute walk program here at TPL. So please keep your eyes peeled and keep focused on websites, actually addresses on the next slide. We've got some addresses for resources that could be helpful to you. You know, as you're working on identifying projects and proposals for infrastructure, green infrastructure and open space in your cities or community, there are a number of tools and resources that you can use. There are mapping and data tools. On the left on this slide is a picture, a screenshot of ParkServe, which TPL has built and provides, that can map out your city, and you can map out green spaces and green park deserts. On the right is another tool supplied by CEQ. It's the Climate and Economic Justice Screening Tool, which I know Chair Mallory will be able to talk to us about. CEQ rolled out the tool in the past year, which will be helpful to, all communities. There are also TPL is available to help with helping you navigate programs, how to file proposals. We're going to have future webinars, as Diane said. We have peer learning networks as part of our 10-minute walk, and there's one-on-one support, office hours, et cetera. So please follow us, stay in touch, and we can provide application guidance. We are really looking forward to working with all of you, all of our partners, on this incredibly important and timely work. Thanks so much, and I'm going to hand the mic back to Diane.
Thank you, Bill. As you hear, there's a really exciting scale of opportunity here, and I know a lot of questions. Some of you have started to put your questions in the Q&A. Please add those. If we can't get them today, we will also look for ways to reach out to you. I noticed a number of folks are asking whether you'll be able to share this webinar. The answer is yes. It's on the Park Bench Chat website. We'll give you the website address at the end. Let's dive into our panel and kick off a real conversation about ways that we can help communities navigate and use the wide range of funding sources to advance important green space and green infrastructure projects. I'd like first to introduce someone I've respected for many, many years, and I'd like to welcome White House Council on Environmental Quality Chair Brenda Mallory. Chair Mallory advises the president on the environmental and natural resource policies that improve, preserve, and protect public health and the environment for American communities. She's focused on addressing the environmental justice and climate change challenges the nation faces while advancing opportunities for job growth and economic development. Chair Mallory is from Waterbury, Connecticut. She began her environmental law career in private practice and has served in a number of senior roles, both at the Environmental Protection Agency and in the White House Council on Environmental Quality. Chair Mallory has long been committed to working to ensure that America's environmental laws serve everyone. Her leadership is widely known, and she leads a wide range of stakeholders in advancing environmental justice and diversity. It's truly inspiring. We're so excited to have you joining for today's conversation, Chairman Mallory. Chair Mallory, let me start with a question for you. It's been so inspiring to work with you, especially on making access to nature a priority in America the Beautiful. Could you provide us a little bit of an introduction to the Council on Environmental Quality and some of the key initiatives that you'd like folks to know about?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, thank you, Diane, for such a warm introduction. I, too, have been a fan of yours for many years, as you know. And hello, everybody. It's just such a thrill to be here. This work that Trust of the Public Lands does and that we are able to partner with them on, in particular around parks and equity, is just such a gratifying part of the work that we do. And I just express a huge thanks to TPL for actually putting on this webinar and for helping to kind of get the word out of the opportunities that we think are available as a result of just historic levels of funding that are now available for these specific purposes. And I just have to say for a minute, I'm just so grateful to have a chance to work in an administration that really understands the strong correlation between having outdoor access and quality of life. And those are issues that I think for a lot of us became very front and center during the pandemic, when we were all focused on the way that communities were responding to this great pandemic and what a difference it made if you happened to live somewhere where you had access to the outdoors. And so just recognizing how a simple walk out in your neighborhood, if you happen to be in a neighborhood where that's possible, really uplifts the spirit and makes it possible for you to just kind of reflect on and actually recenter yourself. That's how it works for me. Just being outside for a few minutes helps to recenter and allow me to kind of go back and dig back into whatever it is that I'm doing at the moment. So just excited to think about ways in which we can actually help provide that kind of access for everyone. And our goal across the EQ on so many programs is really about how we make sure that we are creating the same benefits across the country for all communities, regardless of what your zip code may be. In deploying the kind of historic levels of new funding that we have, I think that we recognize the importance of the intentionality of it. What we know and have seen, just because of the way that the demographics work out, if we aren't very focused on making sure that communities who are historically underserved are the focus of our efforts, they will be overlooked again. And so that is why, I think as Bill was saying, that is why the administration is making it such a priority as we talk about it, because we're trying to achieve that overall goal of everybody having the benefit of the green and blue space that we know really matters, that the bike paths and trails and safe routes to school and other outdoor areas are really available for folks. And so that's really ingrained in the kind of overall ethos that I think that we're working on here at CEQ and across the various programs. America the Beautiful is obviously one in which we are very focused on. It's the president's kind of conservation commitment to preserve or protect 30% of the land and water by 2030. And in that, a key pillar of it is looking at how that affects communities in an equitable way. And in the last 2 years, the president, through various efforts, has already invested $10 billion in conservation, which is more than any other president in modern history. And so you can see that this is an area in which the president has really prioritized how you make that connection between the historic climate and environmental benefits with ensuring that all communities are getting or reaping the kind of benefits of these areas. The transformation that was empowered by the Inflation Reduction Act, and I think we talk a lot more about that these days because it's the most recent, and it's one in which no question the single biggest climate investment in United States history. And so it really does enable us to kind of integrate the notions of equity-centered green space expansion as a real strategy in what we're trying to do. And with in close coordination, I think, not only across the federal government, but also with state and local governments and private and nonprofit partnerships, like with TPL as others. So, but when you look at the combination of what the bipartisan infrastructure law has done in sort of providing a kind of a groundwork for protecting our lands and waters, the president has secured $12 billion in once-in-a-generation investments that will really power us towards our goals, looking at those two laws in particular. I think Bill adding ARP and funding beyond that, I think, really kind of gives a broader perspective on just what we've done as a nation over the last few years in terms of parks. But the two key infrastructure-related laws that I'm talking about is where we get the $12 billion figure. Bottom line is a lot of money.
We'll have the opportunity to spend it well.
Exactly, and key, and that's why this conversation is so important. And I think when we think about the funding, we're trying to figure out and trying to position ourselves so that we're improving kind of community green space and the planning of trees and the, you know, cleaning up of polluted areas and reducing effects overall on environmental of injustice activities, and, you know, really addressing sort of destructive impacts on that relate to kind of urban heat, which we see the devastating impact that that's having in terms of people's health. So a lot of good work, all interlinked, and I think that's a really important point of the president's agenda. It's all kind of interlinked. We often talk in silos about conservation and climate and Clean Air Act, but when you look at the impact that they have on people, they're all interconnected. And so
in all lands in particular places.
In communities. And so you can be working on all of those at the same time when you're trying to address these issues. One of the things that we did last year to try to facilitate this specific work around parks and equity or green space and equity was to create, we signed a kind of memorandum of understanding across 10 federal agencies. And we recognize that the way we receive our money comes in all of these different little pots. And so it's really important for us to have mechanisms in place that allow us to kind of work together closely. And so the goal of the MOU is to kind of prioritize the communities that have generally been locked out of some of these benefits, and also to just ensure overall that we are providing access to kind of safe parks and natural areas and waterways in communities where all Americans kind of live, work, and play. And all of the agencies that are part of this effort are really committed to working together with each other and with the partners in the community. So for those of you online today who are listening in, that the idea of kind of bottom-up approaches where we're really listening and learning is really critical to the work. And so I think the main goal of making sure that everyone everywhere really gets the benefits of the land and great lands and waters that we have access to in this country and that we are working so hard to really amplify and enhance is really our main goal. And so with that, I just wanna thank everybody for the work that you're doing, and I'm grateful to be here.
Thank you, Chair Mallory, really appreciate that. And I think that the changes in some of these laws in America, that the America the Beautiful plan to really focus on people and communities and not just have green space thought about as a far away thing that doesn't matter to people is so important. And I want to get to how these programs land and how some of the leaders at the local level are finding ways through. And I'm really thrilled to introduce Mayor Danene Sorace of the city of Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Danene Sorace was elected to serve as the city of Lancaster's 43rd mayor a couple of years ago in 2018. She's the second woman to hold this post. And she is a 10-minute walk champion mayor. So thank you for that, Mayor. She's committed to strong neighborhoods, safe places, a sustainable economy, and sound government. Now, before serving as mayor, she was on the city council. And before that, she played a leadership role in the community by directing an environmental organization that partnered with the city of Lancaster to put in place their first ever green infrastructure plan. So the mayor's seen this from lots of different perspectives and brought success. Mayor, let me start with a question for you. So you've been a strong advocate for green investments, for park investments, for equity, for access. And I know our TPL Pennsylvania and 10-minute walk teams have been absolutely thrilled to work with you in recent years to help rally mayors across Pennsylvania and to share important information about federal parks funding. We're so excited to be partnering with you right now on parks in Lancaster. But could you share a little bit more about your key priorities, how parks fit in, and any observations you have about how these programs land for you?
Well, thank you, Diane. I am really appreciative of being here, and the Trust for Public Land has just been a tremendous partner to the city, and I'm looking forward to talking more about how we've been able to partner with the Trust to advance some of our objectives. Just to situate everybody in the context, because there's lots of Lancasters across the United States, we are in South Central Pennsylvania. We're a city of 60,000 people. We are majority minority. About 30 to 40% of our residents are Hispanic, and we've been dubbed the refugee capital of America. We have the largest per capita number of refugees from across the globe, which makes our city really rich, very interesting, and we have really terrific food. I just came from lunch, which was an amazing a buffet of food from around the world. So this is our community, and the ways in which the public land and public spaces and parks in particular shape and infuse our goals. My vision to start is to create a stronger, more equitable Lancaster block by block. And as you mentioned, I have four strategic priority areas, and two of them really dovetail with parks and open space. And they have to do with strong neighborhoods as well as safe places. And we all obviously saw the impacts of COVID in our communities, and it also really shed a light on the south of our city that has been the subject of urban renewal and the destruction of a lot of our community and the fabric of our community 50 years ago, and the ways in which those communities that have that were part of urban renewal continue to have the legacy of what that means as it relates to public infrastructure and access and availability to quality public parks. And I also just want to underscore that parks are workhorses for us. We're talking about all the ways that we're weaving together what parks mean and connecting conservation and climate action and resiliency and air quality. Here in Lancaster, we're connecting them to being an age-friendly city, our active transportation plan, our green infrastructure goals as it relates to stormwater management, as well as recreation and engagement with young people through our rec commission, and the ways in which parks are those safe places that children can gather in the summer and be safe and participate in activities and have a place that is their own in their neighborhood that's beyond the walls of their house. And that is a little bit about how all of this ties together. And I'm looking forward to this conversation, and I'm already learning. And we have team members that are on this call as well. So thank you for the invitation.
Well, thank you for joining us. And I'm seeing some love for Lancaster in some of the comments. As a reminder to everybody, if you'd like your question to be considered and answered either on this panel or by your staff later, please put it in the Q&A. And I'd like to welcome now Juan Perez Sayez, who's the Executive Director of Environmental Learning for Kids in Denver, Colorado. It's a wonderful nonprofit that we've had the opportunity to partner with. Juan has dedicated his personal and professional life to conservation, advocacy, environmental education, and stewardship. And Juan, I think you've got a lot of fans on here. I see a lot of applause going up. So You're very welcome. One has 15 years of experience in the field, and he previously worked for the Wilderness Society, where we focused on strategic partnerships. He's worked in lots of nonprofit organizations in Latin America and the United States, as well as for the US federal government. So he brings a really wonderful set of perspectives. And he's joining us after on a pretty important day in Colorado where the governor is being inaugurated today. So thank you very much for taking time out to join us, Juan. So it was amazing. I got to see you in person in Denver, I think a couple of months ago, and I loved visiting Montbello Park and seeing the kids playing on the boulder there that North Face sponsored. Environmental learning for kids is such a wonderful partner. Could you share with us just a little bit more with the audience about what ELK takes on?
Of course, and thank you so much for having me. Very happy to be part of this panel. I am an outside of Denver, lands of the Ute, Cheyenne, and Sioux people, and I can now, start sharing the story of ELK without recognizing that that we are on ceded land of Native communities, and you know, park equity also means recognizing the history and learning from what we have done and what we can do better. Juan Perez Saez, pronounced he, him, él, and you know, very happy to be an executive director now for Environmental Learning for Kids. We see our mission as cultivating a passion on science, leadership, and service in a racially diverse community of learners and also socioeconomically diverse community of learners. For reference as well, as the mayor shared, we are in Northeast Denver. So when you think of Colorado or Denver, you might think of skiing and mountains and water and forests. But the truth is, we serve a community that per area, we have fewer trees than the rest of Denver. We are, our community, our families have lower socioeconomic status, predominantly Latino, Hispanic, Latinx, Chicano. The second largest demographic is African American and Black families. And so, in fact, over 90% of our students identify as a Black, Indigenous, or people of color. And we serve over 5,000 students every year. With that in mind, I usually like to put it like, when we think about the park, the Montbello Open Space Park, if you ever watch the Parks and Recreation series, I usually tell people this is like the Parks and Recreation of real life, but led by people of color. Like There was a vacant lot, people saw it, and they thought, wouldn't it be great for us to have a green space, a park? And this would have never been possible if it wasn't for the truly intentional collaboration and partnership among community, state, local government, federal funding, and other nonprofits like Trust for Public Land. We currently have just over 5 acres of a park that, believe it or not, was the first park at the city and county of Denver that was designed with outdoor learning, outdoor experience. All the landscape was restored to reflect the grassland prairie, which is the ecosystem natural growth in this area. The students helped to co-create, and they designed the boulder. The boulder you see in the park, they play with it, they shaped it. It was part of the project. We have rope course, a lot of cool features that highlight the seasons, and they can learn about science and get introduced to the outdoors. And I think, you know, I was chatting with the team at TPL, and they were asking about how we like to introduce ELK. And just recently someone told us that we were the manifestation of outdoor equity in the state. And I would like to think that we're aiming to be that. How can we truly share a space where our youth and families can not just feel like they can recreate in the outdoors or in nature, but they can thrive in the spaces. And that's the work that we have done for the past 26 plus years in Denver. And happy to be here and share more about some of the benefits of access to the federal funding and how that has changed the journey for our organization and our community.
That's great, thank you. I think that trying to draw this line from federal, state, and to the community level is what we're trying to get the conversation around today. And I just invite all of the panelists to join us on screen if we'll bring everybody together so we can all talk with each other. Chair Mallory, let me turn to you with a question. So we're seeing issues of equity and climate are being given higher priority. The intentionality that you talked about in federal funding, we're trying to change some of these structures, make sure that everyone has access to the outdoors. What's your reflection on current federal funding opportunities, how do green space fits in, and what are issues you think that local communities, mayors, local community activists and leaders should be thinking about?
Yeah, so thanks, Diane, for that. I mean, I think Bill gave us such a great overview. I was sort of looking at the things that I wanted to kind of raise up just as examples of some of the funding that's available. As I said, we are marking a $12 billion number that we are focused on. And $7 billion of that is kind of related to the recreation trails and facilities that Bill pointed out that DOT is sponsoring. $3 billion of it is for kind of neighborhood access and equity grants. Another $3 billion for EPA's environmental justice block grants are sort of examples of some of the funding that's available. And I would direct everyone to the IRA guidebook as a great place and resource that kind of pulls a lot of the different funding streams together. But the key, I think, in some ways is almost reflected by the two other panelists in terms of what local communities can do. What we know is that every community is different, and the things that need to be kind of focused on in one community may not be of value to another. And so the local communities really have to be the center of whatever it is that is envisioned for taking advantage of these funds, because then you'll get the result that is going to be most meaningful for the community, and is also going to allow for the people who are going to be sort of closest to the efforts to actually feel like they're a part of it. So I just loved Juan's description of how his part came together, and I think more examples like that are where I think we would love to help partner and see and help facilitate through the funding that's available.
Great, thank you. Making these connections is really challenging, and I'm seeing some of the questions in the chat about, so how do we go about it? So I wanna ask you, just as a quick follow-up, Chair Mallory, you mentioned an IRA guidebook. Where do people find that?
Yeah, the guidebook, if you go online, the White House website, and just actually literally Google IRA guidebook, you'll come
find
to
it.
A similar guidebook was done for the bipartisan infrastructure funding as well. And those are kind of two resources that I think that people will find helpful.
Great, thank you. Mayor, I'm going to turn to you now. You know, there's so many federal programs that are prioritizing community benefit and equity in project planning, in selection. How, as a leader of the city, how do you engage the community and kind of make that link between some of the individual block by block needs and what the federal programs are?
That's a great question. And it's not new territory for us. This is something that when I became mayor in 2018, we established the Department of Neighborhood Engagement to really prioritize engagement with neighbors to understand and identify what their needs were. We're in the process of kickstarting our next comprehensive parks and recreation and open space planning process. And it is our objective to make sure that we have a lot more community engagement in this round of parks planning than we did the last go round in 2009. And the way that we do that is by utilizing a lot of different kinds of techniques, both online through Engage Lancaster, which is a really interesting engagement platform where you can track the progress of projects over time and offer your input, both online and then with invitations for in-person meetings. We've been using a lot of community public art and public art engagement to imagine and envision what a park space could look like, and then incorporating public art into the final product in the design. So we just finished a park, Culleton Park, where we have incorporated both murals as well as the design of the park itself, as well as things related to landscaping and, you know, metalwork and so on that really reflects back what the community told us that they wanted to see. There's no way to do this effectively without community engagement, because as a small city, we don't have the kinds of resources to program parks in the same way as maybe other communities do. And so we require a lot of community engagement to be the eyes and ears in and around that park for safety, for programming those parks with community events, and for being partners with us about the needs of the parks and the things that they are seeing in the community moving forward. I'm super excited about this next phase of our planning process, because we're elevating the way that we thought about parks as sort of being isolated islands into sort of the connectivity. We are a very walkable city of 7.3 square miles, and the ways that we're thinking about that and expanding beyond green spaces into that connectivity, which includes our active transportation plan, but also our river, the Conestoga River, which has really been a forgotten resource for decades and really was thought as an extension of, quite honestly, our sewer system, which is tragic because there's so much beauty and opportunity there. Mm-hmm. So we have begun an engagement process called the River Keepers, which is a storytelling and poetry and spoken word effort to use art to engage stories in, and also in the telling of those stories back to the community, to really connect people to the river and thinking about how this next plan can do that. This is what equity looks like, is sitting down and talking with people and hearing their stories, understanding their priorities, and really thinking about how to deliver on the things that they want to see in their communities. And it's different in every neighborhood, which goes to the point of being doing this work block by block. Definitely not a one size fits all.
I think one of the things I'm seeing in some of the chat and questions is a hunger for the practical resources. So if there's a link to the community engagement tool that you referenced, Mayor Sorace, ask you to post that maybe in the chat to everyone so folks can see it. We can also put it up on our website when we post the recording of this conversation. So Juan, let me turn to you for a moment. So we know that partnerships and funding from lots of different sources were essential for advancing your work. It's been amazing. You got some of the National Park Service's Outdoor Recreation Legacy Partnership Program funding. Oh, I got it right. And helped create Montbello Park that way. Can you reflect a little bit on what does it take to get that funding from these big, faraway federal programs down to community? How did you do it? What advice would you give? Any tools, any partners that were particularly helpful?
I will say the first short answer is persistent and be stubborn, I guess, but the more practical, to be honest, we work very closely with the city of Denver. They are a great partner, and we have been able to also allocate some of the local government funding for the park, and they are instrumental for us to be able to manage and administer this park moving forward with their partnership. I would say that the state agency, the Colorado Parks and Wildlife, if you're in the state, if you're a small nonprofit, don't get discouraged. We are a very small nonprofit as well. I mean, at the moment that we started applying for funding, we maybe were a staff of 3 or 4 people, and now we are a staff of 13, and we have seasonal employees. So, and during summer, we are close to 25. But at the time that we started researching our ability to access land and water conservation fund, it was a very daunting process. It was scary. And to be honest, a lot of the people in the organization didn't even have experience of how to process and how to apply and the timelines. I mean, we didn't even have a development team. I believe the ED was doing all the work. And so finding those partnerships with the state and local government, there are always people who know, there are always people who are willing to walk you through the process, they will help you. And I think as far as you have a clear vision, and I know it sounds a little cliche, but if you have a clear vision of what it is that you want to do and how that aligns with the administration of the grant process, I think things could happen. I would say though, it took time. This was a 25 year in the making, purchasing the land, building the park, the co-designing the park with the community, and building the education center. And that's the part that I even mentioned earlier. We do have an education center that opened up just in June of last year. And so we don't just have an open space, but now we're working on how we activate the space and how we make it sustainable. For reference, the lot, which is a vacant lot, a flat vacant lot, it was the classification for development was 12-story building. And if you ever come to our open space, you look to the left and there's just, oh, I guess south, and you see all warehouses. And the future of the land was going to be another warehouse. That was going to be the future. There was a social trail and a lot of trash. Now we have a restore ecosystem, educational components, and, you know, having that mindset of like, how is that going to use this space and how these funds will be actually aligned with outdoor equity is critical to make sure that we get, you get the fundings and you can then invest in the community. Lastly, I think for ELK in our case, a lot of people know us as the organization who built a park, but I always try to reframe that a little bit because I feel like a park alone, a park by itself, it doesn't do the trick. It's not the end all mean all. You need the people. And so now for us, I guess one challenge is like how we communicate to all of our donors and supporters that the park alone doesn't do it. And so providing programming, having our staff, people who look like, sound like, and can relate to our youth, having them providing program hours and developing curriculum so they see themselves reflected is probably as important as of building
having a
physical space.
That's great. Thank you. So this has been absolutely wonderful. I'm so grateful to the panelists for joining us. These hour-long discussions feel like they should be called hour short discussions. But I'm going to invite each of you to, as we get to this end of the hour, to make a quick remark. And I'd ask you to focus on what is the one takeaway or preferably call to action or resource that you would want to share with our listeners. We have hundreds of people online today, and we know many, many more will listen to this this recording. So what's one thing you want folks to take away as an action they should take or a resource that they can reach out to? And why don't I start one with you, and then we'll go around the table.
Sure. Well, given that we have a representation from the White House and a city, I think they probably know this, but for nonprofits, for small nonprofits, sometimes accessing the funds isn't the hard part of it. The challenge sometimes is the reporting. How we make it easier for POC-led organizations who are truly working at the local grassroots and they're doing their best to access to those funds, how we ensure that we don't scare them away, that we connect them, we connect with them and we build true transformational partnerships in the long term, I think is so important. And I know we didn't get to talk much about that, but I believe that there are a lot of great people doing really good work and channeling the funding to those community leaders who are already doing it in the ground. It will be instrumental to secure that outdoor equity and access to green spaces is a reality. And a 10-minute walk from your house is a reality for everyone, not just for some people.
Great, thank you. Let me turn to the mayor, Mayor Sorace.
I would say that it's a lot about building capacity and doing that in partnership with others because no one entity is going to have all the capacity. And so for us, it's been really partnering with our neighborhood organizations and our neighborhood leaders that we've been able to elevate voices. We just hired an urban forester for the first time. As I mentioned, we're working on our planning. In a lot of ways, cities are much better suited to do that kind of long-range community planning but they don't always have all of the resources to bring the other parts to bear. And that's really where I think there's magic in public-private partnerships. And I think to what Juan was saying, there's so many things that a city can do. We can often be the lead applicant on some of these federal funds, but on the other side of the table, there are a lot of other opportunities for nonprofit communities to come together and partner and to really highlight parks as I mentioned, as the workhorses that they are, accomplishing so many different kinds of things in a community and really elevating how to knit that together in a funding application, I think is something that I know I'm leaving this call with a sort of renewed energy about, and encourage everyone who's thinking about the parks and open spaces to really think well beyond what we might traditionally think of a park as.
Great, thank you. And Chair Mallory.
Yeah, so I just want to echo that last comment about public-private partnerships, because in our mind that is actually the key to the success here for what we're trying to do. The federal government can't do it all. The cities can't do it all. We kind of really do need to create those opportunities. But the one thing I had identified as you were talking was the fact that there is more technical assistance funding in this, but these various buckets of money than we've generally provided from the federal government, I think in recognition of really the broad and kind of diverse group of people that we're trying to attract to take advantage of these funds. And so I think that is something to look for, in particular, like when we talked earlier about EPA's grants, EPA definitely has increased technical assistance dollars to really help people figure out how they can take advantage of the programs. And so folks should definitely look into that.
Great. Well, let me just thank each of you for participating in today's conversation. And thanks to the participants who are online listening either live today or in follow-up. And I invite everybody to be part of this movement to connect everyone in our country to the joys of the outdoors. So we'll be hosting additional Park Bench chats and talking about funding for park equity. We'll invite you to join us. We'll take the questions that we learned today to help shape these future conversations. These panels are hosted by TPL's 10-Minute Walk Program, which is generously supported by the JPB Foundation. Please visit the Park Bench website. A number of you have asked if you can have access to this. This will all be posted on the Park Bench website. We'll post as many links as we can that we find that are helpful. And please do reach out to us. The Trust for Public Land works with communities all over the country to help solve these issues, to help apply for grants, help work through. We can't do everything, but we can be one partner in the partnerships that all of us recognize are so important. There's an email address. There's a closing slide that'll come up here in a moment. There's an email address there. Please feel free to reach out directly to our 10-Minute Walk team. And again, thank you to all of our panelists and all of you for joining. Have a great day.